first of all, I have to admit that after the clear presentation of Sally in her perfect British English, my terrible Spanish accent will sound terrible for you, so my apologies. My name is Andrés Bustillo. I come from a small university in the north of Spain, the University of Burgos, and this work has been done between two computer scientists, myself and Juan José Rodríguez, and one archaeologist at the university, that is Miguel Ángel Arnaiz. So please don't do many archaeological questions to me, because I give no answers to them. Then the presentation is divided in five different issues. The first one, to describe the objectives and the archaeological need of this work. Then how we have created the data set that we use, or the four data sets. Coming then to the machine learning techniques that we have used, or data mining techniques, as you want to call them, and especially to the results that we get. And finally, I will close the presentation with some conclusions. Good, just coming to the first point, the objectives and the archaeological needs. In all the north area of Spain, there are many different findings of metallic components that they are found in small holes, where that we call them deposits or hoards, where we find between 5, 10, 20 components. And it's not clear this in the Bronze Age, at the end of the Bronze Age, and it's not clear the relationships that these elements, these strange elements, we can call them prestige objects, because it's not clear what they are doing there. Which is the role that they play in the relationship between the communities that were that the inhabitants of the of this time have, because they were small communities and isolated between them. This is just a map of the province of Burgos where part of these deposits were found. The province is around 150 kilometers from north to south and 70 kilometers from west to east, so you can get an idea that how isolated these deposits, or how far away some of them are from one from the other. You have a build or a picture of one, not of one of them. This is coming from a France deposit, but the idea how this material is found, and which is the kind of material. We have some axes, we have spears, we have also some rings, ornaments. Then they are from very different nature. They are all metallicals, usually, obviously, bronze materials. And it's an open issue, try to understand what was happening to get these findings now. So this was the first, or the archaeological need. But from the computer science point of view, the main problem is we have a lack of data. Most of these deposits are very small, they have only 5 components. There is not a clear dating. Some other presentation have already discussed this point. There is no, when we talk about metallic components, there is not always a clear dating, as Mr. Kali have already pointed out. And we want to test different machine learning techniques to see if these new approaches can extract more information from these deposits than the immediate information that the archaeologists have discussed about this point. So the objectives will be to combine data from different nature, because we will use chemical composition, location, from various small elements, so very, like these deposits, and to compare two kinds of machine learning techniques. As Oliver has already pointed out this morning when he was talking about artificial networks, they are black box models, and the information that we can get back from a black box model is very limited. And we want also to use some visual machine learning techniques, like could be decision trees, so that we can extract further information. And finally, we want to see the influence of the chemical composition and also the location in both in dating of the findings, and also in the typology of these prestige objects of metallic components. Sorry. Good, just coming to the dataset description, the first stage was to do the data harvesting. We won't go to the excavation, we just take a look to the publication that during the last 30, 40 years have been discussing these issues, these findings, these deposits in the north of Spain. Unfortunately, most of this publication, or all this publication, was in Spanish. This was not a problem for us, but it was part of this work to try to join the data and also to make them public. At the end, we have 218 metal components that were identified and included in the data sets. We have dating them in the publication mostly in the late Bronze Age, in these 500 years that you have there before Christ. And all these publications refers to the chemical compositions by means of X-ray fluorescence of the metallic component. Then we have full data sets where we have not empty data. That was the advantage if you compare with the other presentations that we have seen before. We have to prepare the data a bit, do some data set generation. This means to normalize the composition, because there was some mismatches around 1%. In some publication, they talk about traces, and then we give a value and a standard value for these traces. This means there was a very, very small amount of some metals, but it was not measured. And we include the UTM coordinates of the findings in the data set. And as outputs, let's come to this open issue, as we have seen already with the arrows and also with the axis, the stone axis. Obviously, we have dating, and we trust on the dating that the publication have already done, have already given. But the typology of the components was an open issue. Then we decided to use a very general component. Classification, so Marie already took the first level, with 31 different classes. Then in these classes we have six different types of axes, three different types of spears, and three different types of daggers, for example. But then another two classifications that were not so general. One with only seven classes. This means we have only one axe, one spear, one dagger, and a free level or a third level of classification with only three classes. This was ornament, tool, or weapon. So at the end, what we have is four data sets, because we have four outputs, all of them with 218 instances, and we have 11 attributes. Nine are the chemical composition of the metallic components, the other two are latitude and longitude of the location of the findings. Just to come to the question, if we use, because as we will use later accuracy, if we use any metric for balance datasets or not, we use metrics for balance datasets, although if we take a look to the balance of the datasets, they were not completely balanced. From left to right, you can see the first dataset. This is the one related to dating, then the one related to 31 different classes for the typology, the seven classes and the three classes. The datasets were not obviously balanced. I mean, the archaeological findings never are balanced, but at least in most of the classes, there is somehow a balance. Good, and finally, with the data set, we do a PCA, like a standard analysis or pre-analysis, to see if it's possible to extract any clear information. This was the case for type 3 data set, the typology of the metal components, and you see that the three colors are completely mixed, and there was not any clear information to be extracted from this data set. Good. About machine learning techniques, I will be very quick because I think most of you have it clear. We decide to use some baseline methods, mainly multi-layer perceptrons, support vector machines, and especially decision trees, because our research group has focused the last 15 years on research on this kind of machine learning algorithms. But we also wanted to use more recent machine learning techniques like could be ensembles. Ensembles are a combination of different models and usually are more acute than only single models. If I feel myself ill and I go to the doctor, he will give me one diagnosis, but if I have the chance to go to 100 different doctors, 70% or 70 of them will give me one diagnosis, and I can feel myself a bit more secure with this diagnosis after talking to 100 and having the same from 70 of them. This is the background of ensemble. Then we decide to use ensembles of decision trees. Exactly, we use random forest and rotation forest. I think I have some slides for random forest, but I don't think it makes sense. And there is a poster I saw this morning, just out of this door, just describing random forest for another purpose. So you can take a look if you want, just to get a clear presentation about this standard machine learning. But it's already a 30 years old one. Just coming to the results, I think is the most important part. We have used software, Weka software, which is an open source free software. And the results that we get, if we take a look to accuracy, I mean percentage of good classified components in these four data sets, you have in each column the results for in arrows, I mean in lines, the different techniques. We can extract directly some clear information. First, random forest, ensembles of random forest seems to be the most accurate method. The only one who doesn't have any statistical difference with this method is rotation forest, the other ensemble method. So it's clear that we can say that ensembles seems to be a good machine learning technique to model these kind of problems. And also there is some standard information that we can get. If we have less classes, the accuracy will increase. This is if we compare the accuracy of the type 31, type 7, and type 3 typologies. Obviously, the accuracy is increasing because if we have less classes, the algorithm will have will increase the accuracy. But also, all the methods, except with the exception of support vector machines, in some cases, and this is an open issue to discuss. Are better than 0R. This is the standard baseline method that usually predicts the most common class in Weka software. But we want to go a bit farther. Wait a minute. And this is a black box result. We have the best accuracy with this model, but if we want to extract information, how? Then, as unpruned decision trees also have a nice accuracy. It's not so high like the accuracy that we got with random forest, but it was not far away. We decide to build the decision trees and try to discuss them with the archaeologists. Then this is the first one, which is pretty simple, and it's the one for dating. Then usually you read it from up to down, and you are just taking decisions to see where your component is coming. If you take a look, there are some clear conclusions. You can see in the blue boxes, and this is that lead usually marks that if you have more lead, the settlement will be younger. I mean, it will not be so old. This is a clear conclusion, and it was a conclusion that was expected by archaeologists because in this area of Spain, the lead was introduced in the Bronze Age at the end of the Bronze Age. So, at least decision trees are able to predict what is expected. This is a good result because it doesn't happen always. But there are other results that we can take into account. In the red box, you see that the latitude is making a difference in the dating of the components. So somehow it's asking us if there was a movement in the settlements, in the population from one area to the other, because the system is already just saying, okay, if there is 200 years delay there if you change from one latitude to the other. So we can extract further conclusions, or at least we can do new questions. There is also some components, like could be iron or could be copper, that appears in this area and in this area, and also talk us about a shift in the dating. Then it's an open question. Are the people using new metals mines? Are the people moving, and then the new mines have some traces or components, or is a change in the industry how these metallic components are clear? I think we are not trying to get answers from this research, but asking new questions, or at least open questions. If we go to the trees that are related to the typology, the problem is these trees are too big. So this is the one for the 31 classes, and this is the one for only three classes, where we have A means ornament, B means weapon, and U means tool. So it's still too big to understand it from the first view. So coming to some details, there is around 40% of the elements who are classified as tools that come to the same branch, and in this branch there is only four chemical components. This means the location of the setting of the deposit makes no role at all, and we are talking about almost a huge area of Spain. So it's an open question: why all these tools have the same composition, although they are coming from so different locations? They are somehow in standard. Another question could come from these two other areas in red, where the longitude makes a difference in the kind of typology of element. I mean, the same composition in different areas gives, in one case, tools, and in the other case, ornaments. Why? I mean, are they different cultures? They are different influence. So, and you have the same effect in two branches of the tree. And in other cases, arsenic plays a crucial role in the typology, because he's able to define the kind of tool that you, the kind of element that you have. If you have a low amount of arsenic, you are having a weapon, or the case you are having a tool, and this happens in three branches of the tree. So, always open questions. I think the archaeologist already hates us because the results was yes. New question. So, coming to the conclusions, and not to be too long, the main work of this research was done by preparing the datasets, and it takes a lot of, not just a lot of time, but try to normalize and have not empty rows or not empty data. It's a crucial labor if we want to get some results. We have done it with Bronze Age metallic items found in deposits in the Central Iberian Peninsula. And also that ensembles seems to be a very stable and also accurate kind of model for this kind of process. So as future lines, and this is my last slide, we will test new types of ensembles, and we also want to test an automatic detection of outliners. This means metallic components that they are found in a deposit and they make absolute no sense to be there, because it's a way to detect transactions between different groups or human groups in this area. Thanks.